sorry, can I have you close? Good evening and welcome to a child care crisis town hall from South Dakota Public Broadcasting. I'm Jackie Hendry. I'm the host and moderator for the evening, and I want to thank you for your patience. If you tuned in on time, we had a tornado warning in Minnehaha County, so we just wanted to play it safe, but thank you for your patience. Tonight's conversation about child care impacts everyone, whether you have children or not. And we're here because we want to better understand the problem. And we want to talk about potential solutions. And I'm just gonna say it right out of the gate, it's not as simple as expecting one parent to stay home anymore. So for the rest of this evening, our guests are going to talk to us from their expertise and their perspective with me and to answer your questions. If you're watching online, on Facebook or YouTube, you can drop your questions in the comments there, and we'll also take questions at any point in the program from those in our studio audience, both in Sioux Falls and in Rapid City. So let's start out by introducing our panelists, and we'll start West River in SDPB's South Dakota Community Foundation Gallery in Rapid City. We have Representative Pri Poyer, who is a Democratic state representative. We have Kayla Klein, the director of Early Learner South Dakota. And we have Nicole Weiss, the Early Learning Director of the YMCA of Rapid City. And here with me in the Leo P. Flynn Gallery of SDPB's Sioux Falls studio, we have Brandon Hansen, the Executive Director of Child Care and School-Aged Care for MB here in Sioux Falls. We also have Michelle Erpenbach, President of Sioux Falls Thrive. And we have Raina DeBauer with the Keystone Group International, who also helped with the child care initiative. Did I get your title wrong?
All good.
Sorry about that. I'll give you a chance to correct that when we come back. So let's start just by getting to know our panelists a little bit better, starting West River, starting with Representative Pri Poyer, whether you have expertise in the childcare area or even your personal experience and why it was important for you to participate tonight, and then we'll go down the line from there. So Representative, why don't you kick us off?
Thank you, Jackie. It's a little bit loud in our studio, I'm sorry.
We'll work on it.
Well, I am an honor to be here today and have this critical discussion. I myself am a mother of two. I have an 11-month-old at home and a 3-year-old. I have been affected. I am, like many South Dakotans, I am working class. We work very, very hard for what we have. We do the best with what we have. And I actually was not able to work for probably about a year and a half taking care of my children. I have felt the strain, like many mothers across the state, wondering, how do I make the most of my time? How do I take care of my children? How do I take care of my family and the future of it while also meeting my responsibilities economically, professionally, and and health-wise. So I have felt that stress just like many South Dakotans. I know that mothers, we do everything in our power to see a better future for our children. I know mothers who started businesses in their home. I know mothers who pulled together their extended family and, you know, said, hey, grandma, I need your help. I need resources. I need places for my children to go. I got to do this and this and this. There's just a huge gap. Sometimes there's programs that are geared for lower income families. And sometimes there's programs geared for those working class who don't meet low income standards. And they're kind of off on their own, that they have to navigate those waters on their own. And it's been a challenge in South Dakota. And it's kind of, I know many South Dakotans and many people of the Ocheti Shakoi tribal nations who don't feel the quote unquote economic boom that many have said that South Dakota is experiencing. So we have to ask ourselves, why? Why are regular South Dakotans struggling? And how do we best come up with solutions? So thank you for having this forum with many different people on board and having these discussions, because we need to do something. Yeah. Thank you.
Representative, thank you for that. Let's move next to Kayla Klein.
Hi there, my name is Kayla Klein, and again, I'm representing Early Learners South Dakota as their director. I'm coming from a position where I have actually worked in the field directly for about 7.5 years. I ran a nonprofit child care center. I worked with many providers in that time. I helped lead an education campaign with United Way of the Black Hills for about 3.5 years, and then I took over as the director for Early Learners South Dakota after that. So this is not a new issue. This has been an issue that's been around. I would say that the pandemic has definitely essentially dropped a bomb on the childcare field. All of the issues that were there 10 years ago, 20 years ago, have really just gotten worse. I also wear a hat as a city commissioner in my hometown. And the one thing I will tell you is that a lot of individuals from around South Dakota are now saying, 10 years ago, you wouldn't have heard these as the top three main concerns. But I will guarantee you, if you talk to anyone in any community around South Dakota, one, if not all three of these issues are the top three concerns that they say that their community is facing: workforce, housing, and childcare. And two of those things, workforce and childcare, are directly linked together. So I would say in our part in this conversation is that we've really been helping to unite different fields with our early childhood field. The early childhood professionals in South Dakota have really been fighting this battle on their own, fighting an uphill battle, a battle that they cannot win. But I would say that that has changed drastically over the last couple of years. Over the last couple of years, what we have seen is that economic development, chambers, and for-profit businesses, actually those were the ones I heard from the most during the pandemic, have come to me and said, how can we solve this childcare crisis? They're asking for solutions. They want solutions because they understand that the lack of childcare and the childcare crisis is directly impacting the economic growth and well-being of their community. That's a big deal. That is why we should all be concerned about this. It goes beyond just the parent. It concerns the parent, but it goes beyond just the parent who's trying to find childcare. We need to look at this as a broad scope. A new report came out showing that the childcare crisis is costing South Dakota $329 million a year based on lost work productivity. That's huge, and that affects everybody. So that's why we're here tonight, and thank you for the invite.
Thank you, Kayla. And next we'll go to Nicole Weiss.
Hi, I'm Nicole Weiss. I'm the Early Learning Director for the YMCA in Rapid City. I have been working in the early learning field for just about 19 years and with the Y for 14 years. We have early learning programs in 5 buildings throughout Rapid City. And we are looking at about 300 birth to 5 children and ideally between 75 and 85 staff. In addition, I am a mom of three and a small business owner in the Black Hills. And so I'm getting to see the childcare crisis from a few different lenses. And I've also been working, like Kayla said, this is not a new problem for childcare. It was just accentuated and brought to the forefront during the pandemic. But we have been working, I've been working on advocacy throughout the state for years, talking about access to quality care for families, how to staff childcare centers, and just livable wages for childcare providers as a whole. And so again, I'm going to echo Kayla that it's exciting to have more people at the table and have more people understanding that in South Dakota, we are in a situation where both parents have to work. And that's the life that we're living. And so how are we going to help those families to be able to continue to work and to have their children in a place that is a safe and healthy environment?
Thank you. We're going to bounce back to you, West River, after we hear from our panelists over here in Sioux Falls. Brandon, why don't you start us off? Introduce yourself and your either experience or your expertise in this area.
Yeah, so my name is Brandon Hansen. Happy to be here. I'm the Executive Director of Child Care and School Age Care at MB. MB is one of the largest child care centers in Sioux Falls, and we serve 1,300 kids, and that ranges from birth up to 12 years old. 400 of those kids would be in our child care center, and so I live this every day. And we have a staff of about 300 people now. And so why it's important to us is to be able to advocate for those staff members, to advocate for the families we serve. It's pretty easy to be here in support of that when you hear almost on a daily basis the struggle and the need of our families. And so that's really the reason why I'm here. And who does it affect? Anyone who has a child, anyone who has an interest in the workforce, an interest in even sales tax or birth rates, or it really does touch every single person. And so that's why it's important that there is a solution.
Mm-hmm. Michelle?
Thank you. I'm Michelle Erpenbach. I'm president of Sioux Falls Thrive. I appreciate the invitation. I'm happy to be here. There's a lot of really amazing, smart people here today, and so I'm excited to be part of it. Sioux Falls Thrive is the Cradle to Career Workforce Initiative in Sioux Falls. We were created in 2017 by leading organizations here, the Development Foundation, Community Foundation, Chamber of Commerce, United Way, there's five of them, but anyway, we were created, that cradle to career piece is the important part of why Thrive is involved with this particular conversation. We are the facilitator for the Sioux Falls Child Care Collaborative, which sponsored that report that we're going to talk about a little bit. They brought together organizations in town to help fund that and then hired consultants to help us work through that data. And what it really did for us all was point out things we already knew. You know, the Sioux Falls Child Care Collaborative has been active since 2015. They started out as an organization really with bigger concerns around those children who maybe couldn't afford child care or were not getting into the seats that were available. In those days, there were actually seats that were staffed and available and maybe weren't all the kids getting into them. And they were being creative about how to make that work. And as they alluded to in the West River, as the pandemic came about, it just exacerbated everything that they kind of had started to see. And so just bringing that conversation around to how this affects, particularly when we're talking about not only our current workforce across our communities, our workforce in our childcare centers and in our in-home daycares, but also in our future workforce. And that's really where Thrive's perspective is that we're growing our own. With these children that are being cared for in our childcare centers and in our in-home providers, those children are our future workforce. We have to be ready, and they have to be ready to be able to be the leaders in the community that we need them to be. And so that's really where Thrive kind of comes into this conversation. We've been working with the Child Care Collaborative for quite a while now and excited to be part of the work that they're doing.
Thank you. Raina, I'll have you introduce yourself.
Thank you. Appreciate this opportunity. Raina DeBoer with Volt Strategy.
Thank you.
And so I am one of the two parts to the brain behind this consultant work with the Sioux Falls Child Care Collaborative. Prior to going into business on my own over the last couple years, I was actually with the city of Sioux Falls for almost 15. And so that passion for our community and how can I continue to be a leader that helps create a great quality of life, like Michelle said, not only today, but into the future. This was just an incredible opportunity. So Nicole Fluth and I were happy to jump into this work. Her passion is around kiddos. She actually does therapy, physical therapy for kids, specializes in some of those behavioral issues. And her connection, part of her business model, was jumping, delivering care, therapy, directly in the daycare setting, in the childcare setting. So her intimate knowledge of knowing and understanding the struggles and the joys that that work brings, my understanding of the community, how it works, how it runs, and the passion to continue to grow great leaders when they're inside mama's belly is actually where that starts. So how do we create the conditions in this community as well as across the entire state to give every child their best opportunity to reach their best potential and grow beyond what they can even imagine? That's what this work is about.
Thank you. I want to move now to that conversation about the Sioux Falls Child Care Collaborative, that study, that report that came out. Michelle, I wonder if maybe I would start with you talking about some of the folks involved in that collaborative and what you say you found out a lot of what we already knew to a certain extent. Maybe some of the things you found that were surprising.
You know, I'll let Raina talk a little bit about the study. The thing that's important to understand about the Sioux Falls Child Care Collaborative is it includes people like Brandon from MB. It's our large providers in Sioux Falls and around the area. But it also includes our in-home providers. You know, you're going to hear from Karen Ricken a little bit here in Sioux Falls. She's one of those people that runs a business. She's a CEO and entrepreneur in her own small business in her home, providing care for the children and families who have sought her out. And so it's important for us all to understand how that group works together and how we brought that broad range of folks. Because it's not only providers, but it is those organizations like the United Way and other legislators are involved with that. City council members are on the Child Care Collaborative. We all have a role in this conversation about building up what our future means. We all have a role in making sure that our children are cared for during that time. And so the group had been working on a couple of different projects, and the way that Thrive works, and folks have learned this over the years with Thrive, is that we work on a collective impact model. And so that means we bring lots of different folks to the table, and we work in a consensus way so that there isn't a chairman of the table, there isn't someone taking, there is someone taking notes, but no one is voting. There's no ayes and nays, there's not a debate necessarily, but there is a consensus. And so if you get to a point when you're talking about, you're in a conversation and there's something you don't quite agree with, you don't vote no, you say, how can we make it better? How can we make this work for more of us? And so that consensus model really informed how the Sioux Falls Child Care Collaborative was working together. They got to the point where they're an unfunded group. They don't collect dues. They just work together. They do this work out of the goodness of knowing the needs in the community and understanding the industry. And they said, you know what, we need to create some sort of business collaborative. Let's see if we can get the mayor to help us out, see if he would support that. And so they went to the mayor, and forgive me, Mayor Paul, if you're listening, but his comment was, I'm tired of having meetings like this with a bunch of women. Why is it only that women are concerned about the child care issue, and why are we not as a community standing up to this? And he proposed at that time that he would find, and he did, thank you, Mayor Paul, he found $50,000 from a various group of organizations, including, again, the Chamber and United Way and Development Foundation, those folks, Forward Sioux Falls, And they put that 50 grand together and they said, figure this out for Sioux Falls. And so that was the challenge. And the leadership group from this child care collaborative came together and eventually hired this group. But it is that whole concept of how we have all come together around this, that yes, we learned things we already knew. We understand that it's difficult to pay the same amount of money per hour to someone who is caring for children as to someone who is making tacos. There are differences in the business model. I'm not an expert in that, but we all understand this is a different kind of business. Those things were pointed out, but the other piece that happened is that innovation started to be found in other places. And we started to find innovation here. Rana and Nicole spent a lot of time in interviews and focus groups with organizations right here in town, with individuals, with parents, and with providers in town, figuring out what are the best practices, what are the cool things that we really can do that can really make changes for our community, and it's been amazing. But I'll let Rana, I know that there are details in this report that you know better than anybody, so I would throw that to her. What are the things that we found that we're like, holy cow?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, there's not enough time to answer the question.
I know.
Just kidding. I think I'm going to provide an anchoring statement before I answer some of that, if that's okay. Mm-hmm. And that is that a child's brain is nearly 90% fully developed by the time they hit age 5. And I think that's just a really good way for all of us to start this conversation and to add on to the great things that have been shared so far. So just let that sink in for a moment and let that kind of put perspective around the whole issue. So tell me what your exact question is.
I'm looking for maybe some of those key findings or key suggestions from this collaborative's report that stand out to you that you would like to highlight.
Mm-hmm. Let me add one more sort of perspective to it, that there's a lot, right? Mm-hmm. This is a very complex and comprehensive issue. It's not just a singular silo focus or one single home run. It is a whole bunch of singles that if we can mix them all together, we're going to start to make a dent in things. It's tangled. Once you uncover one issue, what you've done under the iceberg is found a whole bunch of tentacles that are very, very interrelated and twisted that lead you down some other paths of other issues. So I think that's also important for people to keep in mind, that this is a very complex and comprehensive issue. Mm-hmm. As we tackled the work, I think it's important that everybody understands, there's a onslaught of understanding that has to happen first because it is pretty comprehensive and complex, right? So once Nicole and I were able to really kind of untangle some of that and get some very clear perspective on the high-level issues and where we can make the biggest impact, we approached that report and this work in a couple ways. And the first is, what are some of those just do it things that we can do in this community? Like, this is a no-brainer. Let's just crack the bat and get her done, right? So there's some of those things. There's also the approach of looking at the set of solutions with all of this incredible data set to say, what are some things that we need to really come together on and collaborate on and be strategic over the next couple years? And we know that we'll hit a few more singles. And then last but not least, a very important perspective is that you also have to look at this holistically and say, what can we do that will leave a legacy? So we already have an issue, and how do we retrofit some of that? But more than that, not only in the Sioux Falls area, but as everyone's alluded to across our great state, we're not getting smaller. So what we're doing is we're layering on and adding on to the issue. So it isn't just about fixing what we have today. How can we stop the bleeding in a couple spots just to stop the hemorrhaging? But then how do we build out a better, stronger infrastructure to plan for the growth and development? And what that means is we put health in all decisions. We put childcare at the table as a solution, just like we do where do we put sewers, where do we put schools, where do we put roads, where do we put workplaces, where do we put the next mall? So when we start to look at community in this more holistic way, we start to say it's not only a transportation issue, it's do we have a childcare so that people can get to work? And I don't even get me started on that. But what I will say to that is people have the opportunity to go to work. That's what we're trying to provide. Everyone has the right to work because work is a vocation. Work is quality of life. Work is a place where people go and they create relationships. They get to use their strengths every day. They become contributing members to our community. So we also want to think of it not only about developing those great brains, but we're providing people work. And when people work, guess what? We have cash flow. And that's not a bad thing. So what are some of the big things that we found? Again, I could just sit here and talk with you for 12 hours if you wanted to, but I've probably got like 2 minutes left, so I'll make it important and meaningful. The first is it's a crisis and we're not moving fast enough, point blank. I can validate for you. I have plenty of reports and data, right? Nicole and I have completely validated, which was important for some of the community leaders to understand this is real. Mm-hmm. And I'm telling you, it's real. Mm-hmm. So we're not moving quite fast enough. So giddy up, let's go. The second thing is I think there's a misconception on the business piece that is really important to mention. I call it a catch-22. I had some really good success explaining this in some of our innovation sessions with local community leaders, business leaders, particularly those that are entrepreneurs. Catch-22, just meaning that we can't quite charge enough for tuition to be able to have a good, healthy rate to have enough people in the workforce, the childcare workforce. And if we raise those rates a whole lot further, our working parents can't afford it. So there's your catch-22. So underneath the hood of that is not a business acumen problem, it's a business model problem. So unlike, honestly, South Dakota, we have other states in the nation who understand at the state and federal level, we have to contribute more to that gap to help our families and our businesses thrive. I liken the childcare crisis from my perspective. I am not a childcare expert, right? I don't work actually in the field. It's like this combination of education and healthcare mixed together, right? It's this, and then you put economic development into that, workforce development. Yes, right? You've got this really beautiful Venn diagram that just keeps spinning. So the other piece to the business acumen is I was really shocked in my own community through all of these conversations to find that some of our business leaders don't even recognize this in their workforce. So opportunity knocking, like giddy up, let's go, right? So if you are a business leader, if you're the CEO, if you sit in the C-suite, you are the cabinet of your organization, you have an opportunity to ask your workforce, what are your childcare and early learning needs? I was shocked to find out that that wasn't just part of your culture initiative, that wasn't part of your organizational development initiative. And I'm not blaming anyone, it's just like opportunity knocks. And so how can you work businesses, invite a conversation to find out what are the needs, childcare and early learning needs of your workforce? I think I've already hit on another one, but I'm just going to emphasize it because it's so important, is just to encourage all of our community planners, whatever capacity that is, that you put access to childcare at the forefront of your planning. How are we retrofitting our current communities and neighborhoods? And how are we using that as a major key performance indicator for how we develop the community moving forward, whether that's vertical or sprawl or whatever that is.
Yeah. So thank you.
I miss that's important that you wanted me to talk about?
That was a beautiful foundation, and I want to thank you for that, and that's so critical. We have a lot of business development, economic development folks that we're going to hear from a little bit later as well, so I'm really pleased that you touched on that. Kayla Klein in Rapid City, I understand you had something you wanted to add during some of that conversation.
Yeah, I just wanted to hit on a couple of the things. We worked a lot with Rana and Nicole and then also the Sioux Falls Child Care Collaborative. And just real briefly, so Early Learner South Dakota is a statewide advocacy organization, and we go from a top-down approach where we're working with policymakers and helping with legislation, but then we also have the bottom-up approach where we're working with communities and helping that grassroots-level initiative come up. And hopefully between the two of those things, we're putting pressure so we can make a positive movement. But the one thing I wanted to hit on is that a lot of those stats that they brought up in the Sioux Falls Child Care Collaborative report were amazing. A couple of things I wanted to hit on just with the business side of things. And Rana did a really great job. But remembering that, so as far as state funding goes, we put zero state funding towards childcare in South Dakota. We're one of the last three, I believe, who have not done so yet. So right now we're all depending on federal flow-through dollars. And one of the federal flow-through dollars is childcare subsidies. That's really one of the only ways you get those. You have to be regulated by the state in order to even get those subsidies. And only 60% of our entire childcare market in South Dakota is unregulated. So that means they don't even have access to those funds. Another shocking number to pinpoint is that we have about 29,000 children who actually qualify for childcare assistance. That's at about the 209 percentile in South Dakota. 29,000 qualify, 1,800. Only 7% are actually receiving childcare subsidies. So that means we have we have thousands of children in South Dakota living in the crisis of poverty, and we're not even reaching them. So that's another one. Another piece in thinking about a business model is nationally, we have a 60% turnover rate in childcare. In South Dakota, it's been as high as 88%. I believe that's what the Sioux Falls Child Care Collaborative report says. Don't quote me on that. We'll double check that. But it's been as high as 80. Think of trying to run a business if you have 80% turnover, even 60% turnover. The amount of training and hiring and cost that goes into that is incredible. And not only that, but let's say if you run a gas station or a retail shop, and we've seen all of this inflation happen. So what happens when inflation happens? Well, you just increase the cost of whatever you're selling in order to make sure you have that profit at the end of the day, right? Yeah, well, in childcare, the only thing that you're selling is care for a child. And parents are already telling you, we cannot afford anymore. And that's what's driving them out of the workforce is childcare. The only way to succeed in a business model in childcare is in order to increase that. And so subsequently, you're pushing more people out of the workforce because quite frankly, they just can't afford it. Or childcare is just realizing that this is not a business they can stay in, and that is where you see constant closures of programs. And not only that, final thing, I think that is a really high note, the average pay for a childcare provider in South Dakota is $10.97. Does anyone know what the minimum wage is? I'm going to say it's really close to that. There it is that. So realizing that childcare is a high-stress, high-pressure job, and when every other market, their new minimum wage is $15, $20 an hour. Why wouldn't I go there for less pressure, possibly benefits, which, by the way, most childcare centers in-home or center-based do not provide either. Why would we stay there for minimum wage, high stress? Has anyone been in a room with 10 two-year-olds? I mean, it's not a walk in the park. Yeah, some of you have in the audience. So I feel like you really have to kind of understand that full picture of why this is not a successful business model. And if it is, that's the reason we're driving parents to stay home. And quite frankly, they can't afford to stay home, but they can't afford to bring their kids to childcare either. So we're in an unsustainable business model, and I feel like I just needed to hit on a few of those additional points.
Yeah, thank you for that. I wanted to jump to, we have a viewer question from our YouTube live stream, and Kayla, I'll stay with you for this because I think you might have been the first person that mentioned this in our intros. This viewer says, I've heard people mention that the pandemic exacerbated the issues in childcare, but what part of the pandemic made these issues worse? If you can spell that out for us, and Kayla, we'll start with you.
Sure. Well, I feel like that was a perfect segue from in how I ended that. and really the biggest part, well, there was many. The cost of food alone. And if you know anything about the USDA food subsidy program, that's another way that programs can get food. Those are the only two federal flow-through dollars, childcare subsidies and the food program. How many people had an increase in their food bill? A lot. Everybody, right? Food costs went up. But what didn't happen is the subsidies didn't increase with it. Neither did, and childcare subsidies did a bit, but not enough. And the final piece that I think is probably the biggest piece is, again, everybody is paying so much more. They're paying so much more. Again, $15, $20 an hour in childcare. We're still over here paying $10.97. And I'll tell you that this was an issue back when I was running a childcare center as well. Many of my employees qualified for subsidy. Do you know how that feels as a manager to know that your employees are qualifying because they're living in the crisis of poverty based on what you're paying them? It's awful. And on the other hand, I had a mother come to me and say, I'm living in my car. I really can't afford to bring him, but gosh, I know that he is getting exceptional care and education here, and I really want to make this a priority. Wow, talk about being stuck between a rock and a hard place. It's awful. This field is so hard. And again, I feel like that kind of, I hope I pinpointed why it's been exacerbated during the pandemic.
Nicole, I want to direct this question towards you. With your work with the YMCA in Rapid City, I know there's some buzz about the partnership that you have with Black Hills Energy and that workforce retention piece as far as Black Hills Energy is concerned. But I wonder if you can speak to how you've seen that evolve and what kind of drive you've seen from the business community in Rapid City looking for a similar partnership.
Yes. First of all, we are extremely lucky to have a partnership with Black Hills Energy, and we were actually working on that and had that open and going before the pandemic started. Black Hills Energy is able to help us with the business model some. They're able to close the gap where we might not be making ends meet, and families can come over, you know, and see their children whenever they want, and so they're on site and they know that they have that care. However, it isn't helping with our staff retention. We have, I think, right at that 80% retention rate with our staff at Black Hills Energy, because we still can't pay them an amount that keeps them in the field. You know, we at the Y are probably leaders in pay in the early learning field in Rapid City. We are above that 1097, substantially above that for our lead teachers. But right now, as a organization, not just our blocking, but
related. So then also serving as a state senator, last session we were discussing what to do about childcare. And if you can hear here today, it's just such a complex problem. And we kind of hit the pause button to say, really, I don't know what we can bring anything this session. What are we going to do? And then as it grew and discussed it, we were talking about having an interim study. But we even realized an interim study, this is so broad, what are we going to grab a hold of? And so it was decided not to do an interim study, and instead we put together a task force, and an ad hoc task force is what I was asked to put together, realizing that really we didn't have enough resources for that. Although we've been getting together and been figuring some things out, what I've really learned in this process is, or in all the information gathering, is we... first of all, I think we start with the state, and we talked about the subsidy amount, and until we go to a cost basis, right now the subsidy is figured on, you know, regional prices where what's being charged, right? And we need to figure out what the actual cost is of delivering. We've done this, we keep doing this over and over. We've done it for nursing homes, we've done it for healthcare. We have to go back and find out what does it cost. And then when we figure out what it costs, then we gotta figure out what we can do to provide more money for the, you know, more wages, right? So if we get it to cost, that cost is going to be based on what it costs today. Well, you've heard that we're not paying enough to even keep. We're having all these high turnovers. And so then we got to figure out how to increase that amount. Plus, I've talked about capacity also. And so if we don't start giving some extra cash for these facilities, for these centers, then they're not going to be able to reinvest and grow and be able to provide more of the child care that's needed. And so you can see it's an important problem, or a kind of a circular problem. And the number one thing I think we have to do is figure out how we're going to raise the rates that are being paid. And I think that's going to be the government taking a look at how we're subsidizing. And then I think that then also, and it's been talked about, businesses are also going to have to get involved and realize that they're going to have to pay more if they want these employees.
Hmm. Because you mentioned the state and we mentioned city government a little earlier, I did forget to note we did invite the mayors of Rapid City and Sioux Falls for this town hall. Both cited scheduling conflicts for their inability to be here with us tonight and talk about this issue, and they did not respond to requests for alternate guests from their offices. We also reached out to the governor's office. The governor's office did not respond to requests for representation on this panel. So if you're wondering about where those two representatives are, that's the answer to that. Senator Reed, is an ad hoc look at this this year enough to bring something in this upcoming 2024 session, or are we looking down the road?
I would hope to bring something in this session, but what I talked about there was increasing the amount that's being paid. And, you know, we just got done, we happened to be at an event that was talking about the future and where we think, you know, the short-term economy is. And we're not going to have the revenue coming the next year as far as we can see. So, yes, we'd like to bring something, but I think the problem's going to be, is there going to be any money that's available to help with the issue?
Mm-hmm. Representative Pre-Poirier in Rapid City, I want to bring you into this conversation. From the stuff that you're hearing today and your own experiences, I'm just wondering what feedback you would want to offer or what your thoughts are from potentially your caucus on the Democrat side about potential action with your colleagues across the aisle and in the state house. What are your initial thoughts?
Well, you know, you could easily look at the government structure of South Dakota and know that we have a Republican supermajority. As a part of our Democratic caucus, we have a different theory on what government's role is. Obviously, that's why we're in separate parties. I think what we really need to start looking at is we need to see and really take an inventory of ourselves as citizens of South Dakota and say, what are we going to put our value in? What are our priorities? In really trying to see, I've seen my colleagues in the legislature, I've seen Republicans do some amazing things. I've seen them work together. I've seen them push through things. When you first get to peer, you hear all these, this is going to go, that doesn't have a chance, we're going to do this and this and this. And I've seen people come together and push something through whenever it matters the most. And I think we need to have that conversation of what value do we put on early learning? What value do we put on our workforce? We have some very intelligent, smart, hardworking people in the legislature. And I really believe that we could come together and say, what are our priorities? I mean, we have big discussions on infrastructure. What about human infrastructure? What about human capital? What about how do we invest and put this in? Because it's not just going to take just the government. It's not just going to take just the businesses and just the we're all going to have to come together and decide what does our solution look like. And I know that the legislature can do things when we agree on what our priorities are. That I know. Mm-hmm. So our Democratic caucus is small. We represent areas that decided to align with Democratic values. But really, what are those values? Well, we believe that everybody has a voice at the table, and every voice at the table matters. We believe in equity. And so I think there is a misunderstanding of what equity is. Equity doesn't mean everything is equal, but it does mean that things are fair. So for instance, take the classroom. You have a child in the classroom and they can't see the writing on the chalkboard. You give that child glasses so they could see just as fairly as the child who doesn't need glasses. That's equity. So I think we need to have these types of discussions and really come together. And the people of South Dakota, I really believe, should start communicating with their legislators more. This is my challenges. This is what a solution I think exists. Is there a way forward? How can we come together and agree? We're not going to agree on everything, but communicating what our challenges are as a whole and trying to find a way forward, I think will change and shape policy decisions in South Dakota, but it's going to create participation from every corner of the room. It's going to mean participation from and voices from everywhere. And I really believe that, you know, the civic engagement part of it needs to be there as well. We need to be communicating more with those people who have the power to make decisions. I think that mothers, families, fathers who have this problem, come talk to your legislator. Have a coffee with them. I don't know any legislator that would deny a coffee date with their constituent. I think we have great leadership here in South Dakota, and I do believe that everyone is willing to listen and find common ground.
Brandon, from your perspective with MB, and of course MB in Sioux Falls, their relationship to this issue will look different from an in-home childcare situation in Sioux Falls versus an in-home childcare situation in Redfield or any number of things. But as you're listening to especially these two lawmakers that we've heard from so far today and some of their thoughts on this, I'm wondering how that aligns with what you're hearing from the people who make use of the service at NB, your customers that you are serving, and this difficult situation that you're in as a provider. Give me some of your thoughts on what you're hearing.
Yeah, so MB is a little different than, it's a lot different than a provider, and but it's very similar in some ways as well. And so, like the Y, we are very proud that our starting wage is much higher than an average, but again, it's not enough. I think it's already been said, but we, on a daily basis, are choosing, do we continue to push our families into poverty, or do we push our employees into poverty. And so that's the choice we get to make every day. There's not really a good answer for that. I need to charge more, but I also need to charge less at the same time. And so I think the comments that they're making are incredibly accurate. I think what's maybe missing at the moment is the urgency behind the issue. We have families who have need right now. And so it is very complex. There are many different angles to take at this. There's probably 16,000 different things we need to do, but these families need it yesterday. And so it's really, how do we figure something out to accomplish that? But I think our problems at MB align so well with everything that's already been said. Whether just because we're different and we are able to pay a little more because we're a little larger, we still have the same issues. We see it every day. We see families who, you know, you might have a teacher and an accountant as a husband and wife who can't afford the childcare bill, but they make too much money to receive scholarship from the state. They receive or federal money. They make too much money to receive scholarship from MB. We provide some of our own scholarships as well. Pre-pandemic, we were providing about $200,000 a year from MB's bottom line as a scholarship, basically discounting our rate for families who couldn't afford it. Our need is probably more like $800,000 today. And so it's just something that MB can't bear for long.
Yeah, Senator Reid, go ahead. Well,
I agree with that we have the urgency, you know, that we know we have this issue. We know that it's hurting families, and we know that it's also causing a workforce issue. I think as we come together and figure out what to do next, when I'm talking from about state level, we have to grab a hold of something, right? I think we sometimes get this, that it is such a complex problem. We hear about all these different areas, what to affect. And I really think it comes back to, you know, let's start with subsidy. Let's start with that subsidy amount. Is there something we can do there so we're actually able to have these? Because I think we're going to have care centers that are going to close. We're going to have child care centers that are going to close. Mm-hmm. We got a cliff coming up because of the money that came through from the ARPA funding and such. That's going to stop. And so I see this not necessarily as, besides that we have the issue right now that it's causing some issues, we're going to have even a bigger problem. And so let's grab a hold of that one thing we can and get into the state. We got to show some good hard numbers of, if we increase what we're paying, what does it do to help these? How many facilities will it keep open? How does it improve the pay? Well, you know, so we can improve workforce. Will it get more parents that are able to get back into the workforce? That's the things we got to talk about. We got to kind of tighten up the package and say, here's what we're going to try to do this year. I think that's the way we're going to have to go forward into this session. Hopefully we can get something done, but, you know, I'll bring it back to, we're just going to have to see where the funding is too.
Right. Are you sensing a real drive from your caucus to look at this issue very closely? Because with the supermajority, I mean, that's where it lands.
Yeah, it does. And there is an urgency to do something with it. Of course, we got to come up with that. What's the answer? Exactly what to do. And mm-hmm. So that's what I hope to bring to the caucus this year is, here's one thing we can grab a hold of. You know, if we can't do this, then we're not going to improve the issue at all.
Right. Nicole Weiss in Rapid City, I understand you wanted to add something to this.
Yeah, I want to speak also of the urgency, and I know that we want to start focusing on what we can do, not what the problem is. But as we sit here, you know, I said that we have three classrooms closed. I know another very large center in town has four classrooms closed, and it was released last week that another center in town is closing. So in Rapid City, one of the larger centers with 140 children and 100 families are going to lose care. And so we do have to figure out something now. And while I'm super excited to hear that the state is looking at the subsidy, and that is something that's needed to be looked at, it doesn't pay the bills. Usually, generally, families still have a balance that they have to pay if they're on subsidy. But we have two programs, one that helps families who are experiencing homelessness, and one program that helps families that are teen parents or single college parents. And of the 50 people we have in the program, the Y and our partnerships through grants are still funding them because they don't qualify for the subsidy because of the paperwork. And so even with that subsidy out there, we have three, I think, out of the 50 kids eligible on a subsidy. And so there is that is great work to have the subsidy pass through and to help those families, but it's also only going to help a pretty small window because most people that qualify aren't getting it.
Do you want to react to any of that over here on the East Riverside?
I think what's important there is we can focus on the state, right? But the amount that folks are being paid is a different subject that businesses are going to have to realize. And I always ask a business, what is the cost of getting that person to work for you? What do you need? If you're going to have to pay more for that person to get your business going, that's what it's going to be. I mean, it's going to have to balance out. It's going to have to be a market-driven decision that they have to either pay more or they're not going to have the employee, one or the other. Mm-hmm. That's how they got to look at it.
Right. Kayla Klein, I want to bring you into that conversation from how you're working with providers, both from your own experience running this and then who you're working with just around the state. What's the sense that you get from them? Are providers looking to state government to be part of that solution? Is there a reliance on state government to be part of that solution? I guess would be that question.
That's a little tricky because, again, I mentioned that 60% of the market is actually not regulated and so not even eligible for the state. But I think at some point in time, we're going to hit a breaking point where we don't really have a choice but to have the state do something. Yeah, that's that's hard. I've talked with a business, East River, who has essentially said that he's going to be increasing his fees 20%. And he's a for-profit center. That's what he has to do to stay open. And so parents will either pay it or they won't. You hear from places like MB or some nonprofit centers, like when I was directing the child care center that I was in, we had to raise between $80,000 and $100,000 a year just to pay payroll and make sure that our budget was, we balanced out at the end of the year. That was just a part of what we were giving back. We knew that we weren't going to try to outprice. We were in a high tourism area. We knew that parents that we were serving, 30% of them qualified for child care assistance and were receiving child care assistance, which meant that we were in a community where parents were struggling. But as soon as you start to have the market continue to increase the fees, you're really just going to be providing care for those who can afford it. You're forgetting about your frontline workers who are, you rely on as your barista in the morning to serve you your coffee and who are working at McDonald's and helping you bag groceries at Walmart. It's those individuals who are priced out. So are we okay with that?
We have David Owen joining our panel here in the Sioux Falls studio. Welcome. David Owen is the president of the South Dakota Chamber of Commerce, and I appreciate your willingness to come on today with your just overarching view of that business community with your work with the South Dakota Chamber. And I just wonder if you would give us kind of those foundational thoughts from to this point as we're looking at that business community's piece of the puzzle.
Well, we got into this whole issue about 2 years ago, kind of by accident. All these people that have provided care and dealt with these policies kind of walked in through the front door. We kind of ended up coming in through the plumbing because our focus initially was watching the legislature try to deal with the issue of affordable housing. And I personally have brought to my board of directors a reluctance to think that subsidizing housing worked real well in terms of reducing the price. So I brought to my board the question that says, how much do you have to make to afford a house? Well, that answer turned out to be, with really bad math, turned out to be 60, 70,000. It's probably closer to 80. Do we have those kind of jobs in South Dakota? Well, the answer is yes. We have a lot of them. Otherwise, the housing market wouldn't be as high as it is. But what that doesn't answer is where we have some of the worker shortages: nurses, welders, entry-level businesses. If you need 60 to 70,000, two people working $15, $20 an hour can afford that house. But not if half of one of those salaries gets invested, has to be invested in child care. So we started asking ourselves, let's look at this child care industry. And that's when the headache started. Because this is, as you've heard all day, really complicated. Now, there's some great innovative answers, and Kayla Klein's led a collaborative that we're proud to be part of that looks at shared space and tri-share with businesses, government, and parents splitting the cost of child care. And there's all kinds of businesses that open child care. That's at the top end, we just heard. They can afford those kind of prices. At our last board meeting, Kayla Klein was there, Carrie was there from MB, and we kind of started to look at these middle income, lower income budgets. And my board now has a better understanding of what it might take. And I think you will see us between now and the start of the next session embracing Senator Reid's proposals and ideas that says, maybe this needs to be for those entry-level positions, those small businesses that aren't going to increase wages that much because they're caught in the same trap childcare is. Maybe this is a shared resource that we ought to talk about using common resources for.
Nicole, with the YMCA, I wonder if you can bring us back into that sphere, looking at your how the YMCA has partnered with other business other businesses, and how that relationship has worked when you're contracting, providing this service for a specific business that has invested to some extent into that. Talk to us about what that relationship looks like with a business, if there was a business in this case that has the ability to invest in it from that perspective.
Yeah, I think so that with our, and I'm only speaking of with some knowledge, I run our childcare program, but I didn't help create the partnership, and I don't know all the financials of it. But I know that by Black Hills Energy providing us with a building, that takes that cost off of childcare. So that is less that we have to charge parents because we don't have to pay for the facility. Black Hills Energy is paying for the lights and the water and all of the utilities that go in. And so, again, that's more money that we don't have to charge to families. And so it really just helps lower the overall cost of what goes into that business model. Still, we're at a point where we're dealing with the crisis as well and trying to figure out how to not raise rates more as utilities go up and as the building goes up for Black Hills Energy. But it does take a heavy burden off of the why to be able to house those 50 kids and care for 50 more kids and not have the building and the utility costs on top of it. And it's obviously a recruiting tool for Black Hills Energy to be able to say, we know childcare is really, really hard to find, but we do have 50 spaces on site that go to you guys first.
Thank you for that. I want to, we have another additional panelist over here in Sioux Falls that I want to rope in, State Representative Linda Duba from District 15 on the Democratic Caucus. I've seen the facial expressions from the gallery, so bring me into your perspective on our conversation so far.
First of all, thank you for having us all on this panel. My perspective is this, that we are working together. There are several legislators who are realize that this is not a Democrat issue. This is not a Republican issue. This is a crisis in South Dakota and in our country. So we most recently, there were six of us who went to a early learning summit in Nashville and heard from industry experts, other states, legislators, policymakers on ideas. And in fact, Senator Reid talked about it briefly,
What we need to understand is, in order to solve a problem, you need information. You need data. You can't go in and say, hey, this is a crisis. Let's go throw money at the issue. Nobody's going to approve that. I serve on appropriations. I can assure you that would not happen. But what I can tell you is this. We need to understand all the sources of funding that we currently have in the state. How are they being leveraged? Where are they not being leveraged? Do we have overlap with different agencies within state government? And what can we do with that information? And so we are going to be working towards that initiative and gaining some slight funding to make that happen, to work with a group called the Hunt Institute that specializes in this. They're a nonprofit. They work with state governments. That's what they do. And we'll find out what we do know and what we don't know. And then we can start to really think about what our next steps are. And again, remember, this is important, and I believe it is important not only to the legislature, but to those families out there. And I think everyone in this group tonight has pointed out also the importance of the child. Let's not lose sight of this fact. This is about our children and about our families. And I don't know about you, but I raised three of my own. Now, I was fortunate, I will say this, I worked at Citibank. We had facilities. It was wonderful. And I wouldn't have left there for anything in those growing up years for those kids. But we don't have that solution for most of our families in South Dakota. We've talked about cities. We haven't talked about the rural problem. Let's not forget about those small towns and what are they doing. So we're going to look at this information. We're going to find out what we do and don't know, and then we'll be able to start to make what I call good decisions. But we don't do that in a vacuum. We need providers. We need parents. We need state legislators, government. We need the chambers. It's an all hands on deck, and we'll be looking for multiple ideas and ways to solve. There is not one magic bullet. If we had it, we'd do it. Take a deep breath.
I have this question that I've debated asking because it gets into some shady territory, but I'm going to offer it here and we'll see what happens. Because in my conversations with acquaintances in different generations than mine, mm-hmm. even from women, mm-hmm. what I hear is if moms would just stay home, mm-hmm. that would solve the problem. Mm-hmm. And
it's not realistic.
Say more.
Well, and I've had conversations with, men of a certain age. not this one. David's very enlightened, I promise you. But the comment was, well, you know, when our kids were little, we left them at the babysitter, too. I know what daycare is, what this crisis is about. No, if you left your children at a babysitter, you don't understand the level of the issue that we're talking about. And so I guess I just wanted to bring this around, circle this around just a little bit to talk about one of the pieces we keep saying is how complicated this is. There are so many pieces and parts, and my organization put together 150 pages worth of its cafeteria-style solutions. You can go in and pick what works for you. It's amazing. But we need collectively and statewide some kind of leadership on this. It has to, and I think, and Kayla is doing a great job in Rapid City leading the change for that part of our state. And I would say that the Sioux Falls Child Care Collaborative is doing a pretty decent job of pulling those things together here in Sioux Falls. We have to figure out, and we need to establish and take responsibility for this issue collectively. We need to put somebody in charge, and we need to follow that leader. And I don't mean that in the terms of, again, that I come from a collective impact model. Let's pull together organizations that really can come up with some of the solutions that will work here. David mentioned the tri-share model. We're seeing that happen in other places. It's amazing. It can really make a difference. Let's pick something and let's go with it, but let's do it together. And then my final thing would be, I don't have a whole lot of faith, and I love you, Linda, but I don't have a whole lot of faith in the state coming through on some of the issues that are there, and you know that, Tim. We need to start as local communities, and Rapid City and the Black Hills have been a great example of that. They didn't wait for the state to come in and say to Black Hills Energy, hey, would you open 50 seats in childcare? They just did it. And so Sioux Falls feels that way in a lot of ways as well. That it's time for us to, let's make some solutions here and now. Yes, let's remember our rural friends and neighbors, and let's see if we can't provide some ideas for them as well, but let's just get going and start with some leadership at the local level and at the state level. And if it's the state chamber that leads it, that'd be really cool. I mean, you could be that collective, collaborative group, but it's gotta be somebody, and we've gotta figure that out first. Because if we're not all working this together, all we do is sit and say, this is so complicated, we're just never going to figure it out. No, it's as simple as leadership.
I don't disagree. I do want to add, when we talk about women, you know, why doesn't she just stay home? Well, we know in the economy that we live in today that it's just not feasible for many families. It is a choice. And if you choose to stay home, I will never say that's a bad thing. Because we know the importance of child interaction in that birth to five experience. It's very critical, and even after school. But at the end of the day, this is not realistic for over 80% of people who have children under the age of six. And I also want to point out those kiddos that need a place to go after school and in the summer. Let's not forget those kids, because there are thousands of them out there. So that's why this is so important. Michelle, leadership is critical. I'd like to believe, I'm optimistic, that we can come up with a leadership type group that can drive this bus. And that is yet to be seen, but I believe that's true.
Let's do it.
I agree.
Let's go.
Let's go.
David, I think I almost heard a bit of a challenge there.
Oh, from, I thought it was an Michelle. Invitation.
An invitation. That's a much nicer way to spin it.
I think you're going to hear the business community viewing this entirely differently, because I've been working with my board of directors over the last 2 years to get there. And the answer is, in this economy, as the representative said, you can't take 30% of the population and tell them you must stay home. The really interesting thing that came out during my September board meeting, when we had these people in to talk about this issue, when you think about it, this is a temporary cost that happens at the worst time, because we have kids when we're just starting careers, when we're paying off student loans. We don't means test contraception here, so you can have a family and start it while you still have energy to do it. But this child care industry has gone through the same inflation that we have. I've never seen. I've been in this business for 40 plus years. Yeah, I'm the old white guy. We haven't seen this kind of wage inflation, and it's racking everybody. But it, with workforce shortage and trying to afford some housing, this converges in a place that says needs a different answer.
Kayla Klein in Rapid City, we've talked in other conversations, just the two of us, about that need for that collaborative space, so it's not sects of people doing different things in different corners. When you hear the need for that statewide leadership piece, what does that mean?
You know, I honestly feel like a lot of that is happening. I mean, we have seen so much momentum within the Early Learner South Dakota leadership and trying to bring that voice together. We are here for all children, birth through age 8, child care, informal, formal, after school, before school, summer care. We've been working since 2019 to try and unite this voice, and I believe we've been really successful at doing that so far. So I'm right there with Representative Duba, where I feel like we're very close to having that, to having someone drive that bus, and the partnerships are there. And again, like I mentioned, we see economic development and business and chambers all coming around with the field. you know, I think we're there. Let's just, and like Michelle said, let's just get it done.
Representative Poyer, when we're talking about our rural communities and the needs there, and also our tribal communities and the needs there, I wonder if you can speak to some of your neighbors and community members that you're seeing those challenges in this space.
I think that as people who live in South Dakota and we are members of the Ochate Shakoi tribal nations, our tribal communities are used to hardship. Our tribal community, this is a crisis across the state, but a lot of parts of Indian country have been in crisis for a number of years. And I think that when you don't have much, you almost tend to not realize how much you're missing. Being in Rapid City, being in Sioux Falls, my husband and I call it the land of plenty. There's some legislators that went to Nashville. Wow, land of plenty. I mean, the ability to have anything you want at any time with a touch of a button, or have food delivered to your, like, that's incredible. And there is a lot of people in these rural areas that don't want to live in the cities. They want to thrive where they lay their heads at night. They want to see their children thrive. They want to see their future down the road to be bright. And having the lack of resources in the rural communities, I mean, in the rural areas, you either depend on your own, depend on your extended family, or you depend on that rancher 10 miles down the road. We are known for coming together when something is needed. We are known for taking care of our own. We are known for being creative when resources are short, when the snow is piled up, when a house burns down. We are a great community. We belong to each other. And what we should be asking your representatives, your legislators, what you should be asking of your government is, well, what is the role of a functional government? That is to create conditions so that you could thrive, not just in the cities, in every part of South Dakota and every Ochate Shakoi tribal territories. You should be asking your government that. And if your government does not reflect your values, then you should make it known. You should show up in spaces where decisions are made, and you should be an active participant in those political spaces. I hear a lot speaking to constituents on tribal lands and off tribal lands and all over this state, and there's a lot of smart South Dakotans, and there's not a whole lot of communication. There's not a whole lot. I mean, we have smart-minded people who are here coming together, creating organizations, trying to find problems and issues. And I think that's amazing, and I think we need more of that. We need more of coming together and figuring out how can we solve our problems together, collectively, and shaping what we want this to look like. So yes, it is, when you have a problem in the cities, it's probably felt 10 times in our tribal nations and in our rural communities. But we solve problems. And if you are not actively working to solve the problem, you should be. You should be. Thank you.
Here in Sioux Falls, I want to welcome Mike Bockerny to the conversation. You're CEO of the Aberdeen Development Corporation and also involved with the Statewide Economic Development Corporation. So I'm excited that you're here. You can talk to us about Aberdeen, but Aberdeen isn't super rural compared to surrounding communities, but you have that statewide piece. What are you hearing from the folks that you work with about this issue?
Sure. Well, thanks for the opportunity to be here. We appreciate it. And you know, I do come at this from two different standpoints, and it is really interesting. This has been briefly touched on tonight, but it is significantly different from when you're talking about a larger city versus rural. In fact, on my drive down here today, I was talking to one of our members of our statewide organization, and we were talking. They called to ask a question about childcare. And this is a very, very small community. I didn't ask them if I could name it, so I won't.
Sure.
But they have an existing childcare facility in their community, and that individual is retiring. And they're going to they gave them a fair amount of notice. They're going to retire at the end of this upcoming school year, so you know, mid-May of 24. And of course, now their challenge is how are we going to, you know, how are we going to survive this, because we've got to have this. One of the first questions that I asked is, I said, well, what's the size of the childcare facility? And, you know, I was really asking for a square footage size, but it really dawned on me that that was the wrong question when the individual came back. The answer said, well, currently we have four kids. We have four. Well, we've talked about business models tonight and, you know, how this business model doesn't work. Well, you know, I'm not a childcare expert, but I can build spreadsheets and build businesses. I've done that multiple times for basically my entire career. Four kids in a childcare center is not going to work. That's just not going to happen. So that's a whole nother level of challenge and issue. And I'm actually going to be going to that community and looking at some different opportunities and some different things we could do with them. But that's going to be a new one. Haven't really tackled that before. But, you know, on a couple of the other things that have come up here tonight, and, you know, we really come at this from an economic standpoint. And, you know, there's been so many great comments and ideas that have come forward tonight, but this really is a workforce issue. And it's a workforce issue that exists now, and it's not going to go away. If you look at the numbers, if we think we have a problem today, this is actually going to get worse, and it's going to become more challenging. So when, you know, David is up here, and, you know, we work a fair amount with the chamber, and, you know, David's been doing this for a long time and got a lot of experience, and he talked about the tri-share model a little bit. We're going to have to do something. And, you know, my good friend Tim Reed, Senator Reed from Brookings, and Representative Duba and others, they're going to be hearing from David and I and other organizations that you've seen here tonight that we can't, the answer can't be at the end of this legislative session, we don't have the money or there's nothing, we can't not do anything. That's not going to work. Mm-hmm. If you want to talk about, you know, a lot of people come back and they say, well, this costs a lot of money. I think they're looking at it wrong. It's not a cost. This is an investment. Mm-hmm. There's a big difference between a cost and an investment. You know, a simple cost is, you know, when I go to the store and buy myself a TV, I'm going to really not get any return off of that other than I'm going to sit there and watch football or whatever it is I want to watch. On an investment piece, you're going to get a return on that investment, and that is vital and important. If we don't make this investment right now and continue to make this investment, the cost to the state will be unquantifiable. Yep. And it will hurt for a very, very, very long time economically. And, you know, I think Senator Reed brought up that, you know, the days of being, you know, the glory days of the ARPA money and all this massive influx from federal money, that's over. Mm-hmm. We're back to normal. And we've got to get really creative and work with all of these different entities and all of these different groups, whether or not you're in Sioux Falls, Rapid, Aberdeen, or in the smallest community in our state, we have to look for solutions and make those investments if we really, truly want to make this work.
Representative Duba, you had something to add.
I really appreciate you talking about the investment, because at the end of the day, investing in this now, there are studies. You can look at the Federal Reserve out of Minneapolis, and they'll tell you $7 return on investment for every dollar we spend, or $9. But the really important factor is this. You have, whether you're at a home daycare, you're at a child care center, you're interacting with people who are working with your children. And we heard from Rania, and it's a true fact, 90% of those little brain connections are put together by the time you're 5. So if we're investing now, and even in those young children who are after school needs, what we're doing is we're creating an environment where there's a positive learning opportunity. How to get along, how to stand in line, how to be a cooperative team member, how to hold my pencil before I get to kindergarten. I could go on and on and on. At the end of the day, what we're doing is we're preparing children for that opportunity so that when our teachers get them in school, it's easier for them to learn how to read than it is when we've got children who've never had that opportunity. And I can speak to that personally from my years at Laura B. Anderson most recently in a kindergarten classroom. But I do want to say we also will reduce the amount of money that we spend in corrections. And we can go get that data for you if you want to see it, but it's a fact. So helping our children now is helping the state reduce cost and developing good citizens who go on to be productive adults.
I understand we have an audience question in Rapid City. I'm going to invite that person to step forward.
Senator. Thank you. I'm Mike Diedrich. I'm a state senator from Rapid City area, and I'm here with other legislators who are interested in this topic as well. It's really important. It's really uncontroversial. From the documentary that was presented about 3 or 4 years ago, we looked at it at the Journey. We shared it. I shared a copy of that with the governor. We talked about the benefits of early childhood learning and child care. And so you guys have done a great job. All the stakeholders have done a good job raising the awareness, creating the dialogue, and now it's turned into a call to action. And there are some specific things. I hope we have some things in the legislature that are related to the regulatory aspects that were mentioned a few times for eligibility for flow-through funds. And also, we also want to create an environment where we're not over-regulating and creating barriers to engaging in the business. But how do we build the infrastructure to facilitate the resources that are necessary to grow it? But that's not my question. I just want to compliment you all on that because it's an important issue. The question is through the collaborative with the multi-sector collaborative, what are some examples of takeaways that have worked that other communities or businesses can use to find pathways under the current conditions to address childcare provision in South Dakota and in all of our communities, including the rural?
I can take that question first. Michelle Erpenbach hit on this a little bit, but the Sioux Falls Child Care Collaborative does have a great many solutions. We also, David Owen had mentioned, the Early Learner South Dakota has created a business collaborative in partnership with the United States Chamber of Commerce Foundation and the Bipartisan Policy Center. One of the first things we did was create a solutions document. That is available for free on our Early Learner South Dakota website, but what we really wanted to do was bring solutions for and by the South Dakota communities. And so what you'll see in there are things that businesses are doing here. And then you'll also see some regional examples. We've talked with the Federal Reserve Bank of Minneapolis. We've talked with the Low Income Investment Fund out of Washington, D.C. to try to get a wider perspective of solutions. But honestly, some of the things that come first to mind are Pioneer Bank and Trust. I always like to, they had a really great innovation even prior to the pandemic. They essentially give $5,000 to each employee for childcare needs a year. That's huge. So that really, and their retention for their employees, that's a great recruitment tool for them. Another really great partnership is Nicole alluded to that lack of overhead cost with space. We've seen some school districts who are maybe, school districts who maybe have an open classroom will offer a space for free to a childcare program in the community at generally a zero cost, and you see some MOUs put in place, but then that child care center can essentially increase their capacity by 20 or so kids and have no additional overhead there. And then of course you have the corporate entities who are putting on-site childcare, but there's a lot of different like business solutions as far as maybe even just like flexibility in hours. Maybe it's maybe a provider can have your child part-time, but you're going to need that flexibility in your schedule from work too. So I would say between the solutions document that we created through Early Learner South Dakota and the Business Collaborative, and some of what you're seeing in the Sioux Falls Childcare Collaborative report, there's so many solutions out there for businesses to take on right now. That would create really great opportunity.
And Mike, we have a few over here that want to respond.
I can offer a couple. Kayla brought up a couple of really good points or good ideas. But there's, you know, it's been talked about tonight. You've got you know, these larger companies, if you're the bigger company, you can afford to do some of these things. But the majority of us all work for businesses that are really super small and don't have that ability. So a couple things that I've seen, a couple we've done actually in Aberdeen where we just have had to get really creative. But one of the issues we had is we've got all of our industrial parks in Aberdeen exist all in the same area. And when we were out visiting with those employers, one of the main issues they had is getting from one side of town to the other. When you have, you know, you got you might live on the one side of the town, but you've got kids that go to school, and then you work over here, and you know, try to make that work was very difficult. And the other thing was shift work. You know, a lot of manufacturing you have shift work. Well, shift work is not set up very well for childcare. So what we did is we really looked at and found a partner in a church, and we put a childcare center in the, I knew I was going to get in trouble if I didn't correct that. I'm still learning here. I'm still learning. Yeah. But we put a childcare center right in the middle of our six industrial parks in Aberdeen. Now, when I took that to our board of directors and some other people, they're like, okay, Mike's fallen off his rocker once again. But as I sat down and explained it to him and said, okay, this is what this is designed for, and this is why this needs to be here. Here's the results that are going to happen because of this. Then it wasn't very hard to get people to buy in. And long story short, what we've seen with that particular center is now we as the development corporation, we helped underwrite that a little bit too. So you've got to have multiple different solutions all in the bucket here to make this work. And part of the agreement is we were going to come in and help them, but they had to open early. So they open at 6 a.m. Mm-hmm. to accommodate for that early shift work. And they stay open until 7 p.m. to accommodate that second shift. Okay. Now that center has been wildly successful. They started off with 40 spots. We just helped them with a very, very interest-friendly loan to significantly expand their presence, and they've added an additional 60 slots. Wow. So they're up to 100. And you have to get, this is part of the whole nature of everything. This involves multiple entities, multiple people, and you have to get creative. And you know, I'm very proud of that particular one, and that's something that we've taken, we've shared in other communities, and that one works regardless of the size of the community. That's just another example. I don't know if our contact information is available, but if anybody watching this wants to know, and I don't have enough time to talk to really answer that question. But that's why one of the key things our organization, we'll help your community, mm-hmm. and I'm happy to visit with anybody that might be interested in learning about a whole other plethora of solutions that we've come up with. Because that's really what we're focused in on right now is solutions. Not, like, we don't need to talk that we have a problem anymore. We know we have a problem. We've got to fix it. So we've got to come up with solutions.
Mm-hmm. Michelle, did you have anything to add before I...
Everything that he said, yes, exactly. A couple of other things to think about, though. The original question was about what are some of those solutions that we could talk about. I think we have to remember, and Kayla alluded to it earlier, South Dakota is living somewhat in a vacuum in terms of there are solutions happening in our neighboring states that are working incredibly well. Iowa, for example, has created its own child care task force at a statewide level, which is proving to help them solve some of these issues. It's a place to collect the data. It's a place to understand how we all work together. The other thing that I would highlight then from that workforce perspective is it's wonderful that the child care center in Aberdeen is able to ramp up the way that they did. There were workers available. That's not always the case in some of our locations, particularly in Sioux Falls. We need to talk about how do we build that professional pathway then. And one of the things that's happening in the Sioux Falls School District right now is that graduating seniors can put in a certain amount of hours in a child care center, take a certain level of classes, and come out certified to work in a child care center as they head on to further education. And then our higher education organizations, you know, SDSU, USD, even Dakota State and STI here in Sioux Falls are talking about how do we encourage folks to understand that this is a profession. Again, I go back to that babysitter line. If I'm leaving my kids at a babysitter, then I'm not going to pay that person more than about 10 bucks an hour. Maybe that's a little high. But if I'm leaving my children with professional educators that have been trained and are ready to treat and care for and educate my child, then it's a different story. And so those are things that this state is already working on that we need to be supportive of to build those professional pathways as well.
I want to introduce our new panelist here in Sioux Falls. I know you as Mrs. Karen, an in-home child care provider, and we have heard a whole lot so far this evening. I wonder, because you're independent, self-employed, in-home, when you're hearing about this business model, I'm looking at you as both a business owner and the brain architect for these young people.
Yes.
What do you need to succeed?
Well, first and foremost, my name is Karen Rick, most affectionately known by most people as Mrs. Karen. I am a family child care provider out of my home, and I am a brain architect. That is what I do, that is what I call myself, but I don't get paid what a neuroscience gets paid. I don't get paid what an architect gets paid. And I'd always found it interesting that as a teenager, I wanted to be an architect. I wanted to build structures and create things. And math and I don't get along. And so that took the idea of being an architect out, and then here I am, I'm a brain architect, which is, if you ask me, way cooler. I get to spend my days that start at 6:30 in the morning and end at 6 o'clock at night. No overtime, no benefits, nothing above and beyond what the tuition is that I receive from my families. There has been a lot of talk about how do we support providers? How do we support the large centers? How do we help with economic development? And one of the things that I keep going back to is if it wasn't for family child care providers like myself, the structure of child care would fall apart. There isn't enough to build freestanding. There isn't enough to build the beautiful centers. As much as I would love that, there just isn't the ability to do that, which is where the family child care provider comes in. And like Michelle kind of spoke about a little bit, was that we are professionals in our workforce. I am educated. I serve on the Sioux Falls Child Care Collaborative Leadership Team. I am on the executive board of the SDAEYC. Because I'm a home provider, I do fall in that wage gap that if I were to break it down, I average about $7 an hour, which is really sad. All the expenses that it takes, there's the cost of caring for children, and then there's what we get in return, and it doesn't balance out. And so unfortunately, because of that, and I'm not the only one, I do have a second job. I work at Avera as a family child life specialist, and I teach continuing ed, and I go out and do a lot of community events and things like that. So I do need to supplement my income to meet my bottom line just to maintain my household. And to be able to receive a benefit, and it could be something as simple as maybe there's a tax break on our property taxes. I live in Lincoln County, but live in the city of Sioux Falls. My property taxes almost doubled. Therefore, I didn't have enough money in my escrow account, so now my mortgage has gone up. And I have to make that up from somewhere. And it's not just that. It's also the cost of food. This summer, I ran a full 12 children, which is what I'm licensed with the city of Sioux Falls and registered with the state of South Dakota for. I served 12 breakfast, snack, lunch, snack every day for my child care children. And my four children between the ages of 6 and 17 who could eat me out of house and home. So essentially, I'm feeding 16 children every day. And so finding that balance, finding that help, that assistance, it takes a really, really smart brain. I guess I'm a brain architect of my own of how do I make that work? How do I budget that out? How do I see that? And it's not just me. I see that throughout the entire state of South Dakota. My cousin is a family child care provider in Prejo, South Dakota, and she is having to close her doors because she cannot afford to make ends meet, and she will be leaving her position as a brain architect to work at the local gas station where she gets paid more, which is really sad because she as well has a degree in child development. And so if we can find a way to support family child care to help with our costs, our expenses, to help us also increase our education, I am huge, huge on professional development and continuing education. I would love to go back to school and extend my degree. I cannot afford to. It's just not possible. There is a conference, the National Association of the Education of Young Children in Nashville this year. I would love to be able to attend that conference to increase my accreditation. I cannot afford to do that. So if someone wants to send me to Nashville, let me know. So how do we support family child care, whether they are only city licensed, whether they're state registered, because we all do the same. We all do the same work every single day from sun up to sundown and even then some. How do we help our group of individuals? How do we help our professionalism? How do we help build what we're trying to do to make childcare sustainable for the people in our communities? And it's not, like I said, it's not just Sioux Falls. It's all over the state of South Dakota. And I would like to point out, I appreciate that Rapid City and Sioux Falls are both being represented here tonight because that shows the unity of this problem. It's not one-sided or the other. We're not East South Dakota and West South Dakota. We are one state, and we need to be acting like that when it comes to childcare.
The thunder in Sioux Falls agrees with you, so we've got that going for us as well. I want to get to one last viewer question from YouTube before we spend our last few minutes going across our panelists for some closing thoughts. And Karen, I'll address this one to you because the question is, what can parents of children in childcare do to help solve this problem?
Well, fortunately, I have some really amazing parents. They understand and value the time that I put in with their children. And whenever I am in need of something as simple as shaving cream, I send out in my, I have an app that I run everything off of, all of my billing, parent communications, things like that. And I will send a message out that says, hey guys, we really want to make a mess on Thursday, and I could really use some shaving cream. So if you're at the grocery store, could you pick me up? And they do. I had one mom show up, and she handed me a bag of 12 things of shaving foam. And they know that when I put that out for their children, the experiences that they're going to have, I see their brains working around it. The parents see the mess. The kids see the fun. It's my job to know what they're gaining from it. And it's the kids' job to have that exploration time to be able to mix together and pull things together and have that sensory and that texture and all of that. A lot of the times, something as simple as giving your time as well, coming in and saying, hey, can I help? Can I volunteer for an hour? Can I read the kids some stories while you get administrative work done? Because yes, we are professionals and we have administrative work that we have to do, which I usually do at 10 o'clock at night. And appreciation is huge. Showing up, I have kids that draw me cards and I love that. I mean, that helps. I've had parents give Christmas bonuses. Not all parents are able to do that. But like I said, just reach out to your parents. Let them know what you're in need of. And a lot of times someone will step up and say, I can help with that. I did a lot of field trips this last summer with my kiddos, and I had a parent sponsor a field trip. And so that was really helpful for them to be able to do that.
Yeah. Two things for parents. One, treat your childcare provider like the professional that they are. Mm-hmm. And two, talk to your employer about your needs and about the needs of your colleagues at work. Mm-hmm. If your employer, and we heard this earlier, businesses don't understand what the issue is, and particularly those folks in leadership roles, they're not talking to their HR people who are running through that workforce turnover. Talk to your employer. Tell them the issues that you have. As parents, you have a vital role in standing up for this industry just as much as anyone that's been involved this evening. Mm-hmm.
I want to wrap up with a closing question. Mike, you get the honor of being the first one to take a pass at it. we've had a great conversation tonight, and I could talk to any individual one of you about this for several hours, and we would only scratch the surface. So while that's frustrating, I'm so excited that we've had this opportunity to begin with each other tonight. So I want to thank you for that time and for that care that we've given to this conversation. So my closing thought, our takeaway for the evening is what needs to be next. And Mike, I'll let you take that crack, and everyone will get a shot at that before we close this evening.
Boy, that's a well. I think I was going to say that's tough, but actually, now that it dawned on me, I don't think that's really hard at all. I think the answer to that question is quite simply, we need to, I think Michelle said it, we need to get on the bus and go. Like, there's no more waiting around. We have to go. We're ready. We've got a great group of people, those that have been on these panels tonight, but there's so many more across the state, and it's just time to go. I would end with just saying what I mentioned to somebody earlier tonight. When I got into this field, you know, 10 years ago, specifically in economic development, but I've been in some sort of development field my entire professional career, I would have never have thought that I would have dealt with childcare. It just never would have dawned on me. But out of all the issues and challenges that I faced, I can tell you there's not an issue that I'm more excited about to be part of developing some sort of solution for. If you can't get excited about developing a solution to make children's lives better and parents and workforce and all the things we've talked about tonight, then we need to have a different conversation. But this is, I'm extremely motivated. I'm excited to be working with all these individuals, and I look forward to producing results.
Michelle, what needs to be next?
What's next? Two things. One, businesses need to do what parents are, I just charged parents with, right? Businesses, business leaders and bosses, colleagues, start having that conversation about what does childcare mean in your business? What, regardless if you're 5 employees or 500 or 5,000 employees, find out what childcare really means to your employees and what is holding your business back when it comes to childcare. And two, it comes back to that collaborative effort. We need to do more of this in terms of sharing all of the ideas, but then we do need to get off the dime and make it happen. And so I'd thank South Dakota Public Broadcasting as well. This is a great effort. I appreciate you inviting all of us. It's been a great conversation. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Yeah. I think as far as a family childcare stance goes, I think more providers need to use their voice and understanding that they do have one, and then reaching out to their local representatives and legislation, senators, everybody, and just expressing their concerns. And then as far as a citywide, we really need to focus on the goals that the Sioux Falls Child Care Collaborative has brought forward and creating that Office of Child Care Development. And how can we as a city of Sioux Falls make that happen? Mm-hmm. To have that voice, to have a unity, someone that we can go to and know that they're going to have the best efforts at heart for providers, for centers, for families. And so how do we move forward with that? I think that is a good next step.
Thank you for that. We'll look to our panelists in Rapid City. Representative Poirier, closing thoughts, what needs to be next?
I can close with this. The most important person in my world right now is my child care provider. The very most important. I say it every day to myself when I drive 20 minutes and drop off my two precious ones. Before I had my child care provider, I stayed at home for about a year and a half. Being a new mom, I exhausted everything I could possibly use. Every resource I could get my hands on, I looked for a child care provider. My husband has a very important job. Being a legislator is demanding. And we have so much that is expected of us as adults. We have to contribute to our community. We have to really live resourceful, resourceful and lives that contribute to the greater whole. And I'm not saying stay-at-home moms, the most important job is being a mom, but when I was staying at home taking care of my kids, I kept thinking, man, I can't go to school for early education to be a stay-at-home mom. I can't go to, that's out of my realm. I know what to do with my kids because I'm a mom and I feel like I could read their minds. But I wanted a professional who was trained and certified in early education. I wanted that person to nurture my my son was so thirsty for knowledge, and I wanted to maximize every moment that I had with him, but I couldn't because I had so many other demands and my husband had so many other demands, and I felt like I wasn't trained, knowledgeable, or to feed his intellectual capacity. I always thought I'm a mom. Of course I'm going to think my kid's the smartest kid in the world. But he was just so thirsty and he wanted so much and I wanted to nurture that. And when I happened to have a friend who knew somebody who had an opening, and I wish that every family could have the opportunity that I came across. I wish that every woman and father could drop their kids off knowing that their kids are going to have a blast. They're gonna have social stimulus. They're gonna have all the interactions with other kids, and they're gonna be safe and cared for and loved and nurtured. That's the greatest stress reliever for me. You know, anything else could happen to me in my day, but I know my kids are safe. And I hope that we, as people who love our children, I hope we can value them and create conditions so that our kids are number one in our lives, in our communities, and in our society.
Thank you, Representative Kayla. What needs to happen next?
I couldn't have said it better.
Turn the mic on.
My own, and let's remember at the heart of this conversation, we are talking about children, our greatest asset, and the two loves of my life, my two boys. Two, there's something you can do that's completely free as an individual or a business or community leader tomorrow, and you could say thank you to a provider. You can start looking at providers as professionals. They're educators. They're not babysitters. Just say thank you. Maybe make a recognition award. I mean, it's a free thing to compliment someone for the service they're providing. And three, Early Learner South Dakota is driving a bus. I'm not entirely sure if it's the bus everyone wants to be on. I mean, but we're doing it. We'll drive a bus with someone else too. I mean, we're all for that. But we have been collecting stakeholders. We have amazing stakeholders and leadership from across the state who represent formal, informal, resource providers, legislators, businesses. I have not ever seen this voice as united, and I've been in the field for well over a decade, and I've been fighting for this for so long, and I think about the days of when I was a director. We have this unity like I've never seen it before. So to echo the words that I've heard many times before, let's just do it. Let's do something and make it happen. And if you wanna ride in our bus or come help me drive it, just let me know.
Thanks, Kayla. Nicole, go ahead. What's next?
Kayla took the words right out of my mouth to start with is, we can't afford to lose more people in childcare. We know that we can't pay them more, and so let's be nice. Be gracious, be kind, treat them, like Kayla said, as the professionals they are. They are choosing to work with your child in a field that is going to put them in a poverty situation where they can't provide for their own child, and so recognize that they're choosing to do that for you and your family and your employees. And then second, we've said it multiple times, but there is urgency. We are watching centers close. We are watching the field go down at a record speed. As somebody who has, you know, I'm on both sides. I have childcare spots, but I'm also an employer with not enough employees, just like everybody else. And so we have to find a way to take some of the financial burden off of childcare centers so that they can pay their staff, so that they can keep their staff and get more staff, so that all of you watching have staff. And we have to do something right now. In a year, in 2 years, we're not going to have employees because we're not going to have childcare. So the time is now.
Back here in Sioux Falls, we'll close out with our other panelists. What's next?
Three powerful moves, I think. The first is a bit of a challenge, but also just a respectful ask that all community leaders jump out to SiouxFallsThrive.org and make the time to read the Community Child Care Initiative final report to see the nearly 40 solutions that we did come up with. Second power move would be an invitation to every business leader to jump out to SiouxFallsThrive.org and read the Child Care Solutions for Employers Toolkit, where we put together a very clean, simple, step-by-step action plan and solutions for any business of any size in any industry to take action immediately to help create that culture of care, to create an incredible environment for performance and productivity, as well as retention. And all of that, of course, contributes to a great community. And last but not least, power move number three would be something that's been said already, and that is, if you're a working parent and you take your kids to childcare, give your childcare provider a big fat high five.
Thank you. David Owen.
first understand that child care has been thin margin on the edge of economic success for a long time. I was on the board of directors of a child care center in Missoula, Montana 40 years ago, and it almost made a socialist out of me back then.
Oh, my God.
We need to know that something has changed. Wage inflation coming out of COVID is a threat to this industry, and that's a domino that this economy can't afford. So if we don't figure something out, we're going to go from child care being kind of marginal on the edges to them ceasing to exist. This needs to be addressed. The report that Sioux Falls did, the work that Kayla Klein has done, needs to be looked at, needs to be advocated by the business community. We need to talk a little bit more, my impression, about this difference between registered and not registered, and the fact that we have a federal pass-through program that's only helping 1,800 kids out of 7,000 is wrong. And so we need to have that dialogue to see if we can get that pipe opened up more. And we need to look at the folks at the low end where we want both parents to work if they choose to. And that's going to be a conversation about using common resources and state money.
Mm-hmm. Totally agree with you on that, registered and unregistered. Did not even get to that tonight. That's how big this topic is. That'll be part of our ongoing coverage. Senator Reed?
Kind of continuing on what David had to say, we've got to figure out that one thing that we can do this legislative session. What can we do to help out? And as has been said many of times, get the bus moving, get on the bus, get off the dime. We just have to do at least one thing. And I think that thing has to be focused on what's been talked about a lot, and that's the wage issue. How can we get, what can we do to make sure that providers, you know, can keep their employees and we can provide, you know, we can pay them what they're worth?
Representative Duba.
So last but not least,
we got one more.
Oh, we do have one more. I apologize. Evidence-based. You know, you've heard the word data, but let's call it evidence-based decisions. Having the information that we need. The Sioux Falls Collaborative has done a great job, but we need to look at this from a holistic state standpoint. We're going to be doing that. And then there are solutions out there. So we take that evidence, we make a business case, make a childcare case, thank our providers, and then move forward with solutions for them and for our children and for our families.
Hmm. Brandon, last word. What needs to be next?
Yeah, I'll be brief. I think we agree that childcare is important. I think we agree that it impacts everybody. It sounds like really the only way through this is funding from many sources. And so at MB, we say we need to build a sustainable economic engine to allow our community to go back to work.
Thank you again. I want to say thanks again to all of our panelists. This is just the start of an ongoing conversation. My hope is that this live stream will be not just a conversation tonight, but an ongoing resource that you can share out with folks if you're watching at home. Here's a long list of people that you can reach out to start having these conversations, including your own local legislator. So, you can keep an eye out for that ongoing childcare conversation from SDPB, including, by the way, the next episode of South Dakota Focus that airs Thursday, October 26th at 8 p.m. Central, 7 Mountain, another half hour on childcare, including hearing from a stay-at-home mom and some of these other voices. I want to thank again all of our panelists, East and West River, for sharing their time and expertise and experience with us and being patient with our experiment with this new format of a conversation. And thanks as well to our audience, both here in studio and you at home, for your interest and your questions. This public engagement keeps these conversations going and hopefully helps us find those solutions. So thank you again, and have a good night.